in a very informal discussion a few minutes ago, you were asking me what I would do today if I would be the Greek Prime Minister. And I said, thank you very much, I would prefer to be Romanian Prime Minister. And that because Romania, I hope not to be too optimistic, but it is in a good moment. And you also quoted a statement, which I did also quote 2 days ago in the parliament, a statement of the central bank governor, Mr. Isărescu, that finally Romania is in a, on a sustainable growth and development. And I would add to this quote of the governor that I just hope that the government and the politician were not going to destroy this good path. And we just have to be very cautious. And I would just say that yes, it is a good situation. 4.2 economic growth in the first trimester, a low unemployment compared with the European average, a sustainable growth, not based like a few years ago on real estate and financial speculation, but on competitiveness, exports and production. So we just have to be focused on the challenges of the next month and next year. And I will refer just to some of them. First, I think that we should be very committed in some of very focused reforms regarding the education. Not the whole law of education, because this is a political never-ending discussion, but just on two issues. One is the vocational education. I keep meeting chairmen, managers of companies who are developing new businesses in Romania, and almost all of them, they keep telling me that now they have a shortage of staff, of people able to work in the production area. So vocational education, it's a very concrete and focused area of the education. The second one, and I've already asked the Minister of Education, the chairmen of the biggest universities, is to simply train more young students on the IT sector. It is the most, it's the fastest developing area in Romania, and it seems that the big university centers, Bucharest, Cluj, Timișoara, Iași, are not able to provide in the years to come the enough numbers of graduated for this very important area, an area of on which Romania could be a regional leader, not a world one. We are not proposing ourselves this, but to be a regional leader, and it has the potential to. The second big challenge is to finally, I say finally because I've been already Prime Minister for 3 years and I'm absolutely unsatisfied with my success on this area, it's to change and to find the right procurement procedure regulation in order to make these procedures not only more transparent, but because they are transparent, but rather more effective. I still believe that 2 years between the moment of launching an important infrastructure procurement and the moment of signing the contract, it's absolutely unacceptable, and this is affecting the rhythm of development of Romania. The third issue, it's infrastructure program. Finally, this month in June, we will have the official approval of the European Commission regarding the master plan on transportation, and I just hope that all the governments, all the politicians will simply respect the master plan, the strategy for the next 10, 15, 20 years. It's absolutely unproductive to have every year the priorities on the infrastructure changed. That has been one of the illness of the Romanian political leadership, and I think that this predictable strategy regarding the infrastructure will be a great help for for all investments and the economic development. Dangers, of course, the regional instability, and you mentioned the political instability created by the aggressiveness of Russian Federation, which moved its frontier from 600 kilometers to 300 kilometers to Romania. I hope they will stay there and not coming closer. They are close enough. But also the financial and the economic and the psychological impact of any negative development regarding Greece. That's why I did not raise my hand when you asked it, because I cannot afford to do it. I just hope that Greece and the Eurozone will find the political solution. The economic one, I do not see it in a very short term, so it should be only a political solution. And that will simply assure the stability of the region and will assure the public opinion in Romania that our political goal to join the Eurozone, the governor says in due times, but I'm a politician, due times should be a clear time. It's a sustainable and a positive goal for Romania. Then, the populists. I am leading a social liberal government, and I'm still afraid of populism, because this is politics these days. There are ideas that everybody knows are wrong, and nobody dares to say it in public, so we will vote in favor of it. So that's why I'll try to be sometimes unpopular, but just saying, all right, we are doing everything we can and everything we should do to keep it sustainable. I just think that, and I'll close with this, that Romania is still the country with the highest potential in the region and still with the worst image, because we are not able to promote ourselves. Now things have changed. Immediately when I stepped in this hotel, I was received by the manager and I asked him, how is business? Do you see something change in tourism, in activity with the VAT decrease? He said, yes, it's excellent. We just have to promote Bucharest and to present the advantages of Bucharest, because otherwise the old prejudice and the old judgments regarding Romania are still in a majority share in the international public opinion. That's why I thank you very much for organizing this conference here, and I just hope that this is another step on presenting the true Romania. Thank you very much and have a good conference.
Prime Minister, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Euromoney for inviting me again to this. It's the second, if I'm not wrong, regional finance and investment conference in Southeastern Europe. And because you opened this issue, Richard, I have to confess that I'm a fond of the Euromoney magazine. And this love, to call it, dates more than 40 years ago, back to my beginning in the career like an economist. I worked those days in the Institute for International Economics in Bucharest in the early 70s, and I recall perfectly that Euromoney magazine was one of the first good magazine, not to say the best, not to enter into competition, but anyway, for me it was one of the most beloved magazine I've read as one of the primary sources of information for currency issue, for modern banking. Then I said this in an interview with you, and I have to say again, and as a matter of fact, you also mentioned I like the magazine so much that one of the persons I was very keen on meeting during my first visit in London, 1976, was Patrick Fallon. those days he was editor-in-chief at that time, and I tried to make something forecasting exchange rate. I was very young and optimistic. In the meantime, I discovered it's almost impossible, but those were the days. Now, in my speech of today, I intend to briefly touch the most relevant developments in the Armenian economy, which would hopefully provide further arguments for you, Richard, and for Romani's choice to organize this event in Bucharest for the second year in a row, and why not also next year, and the year after next year, it will become a tradition to have this seminar in Bucharest. Anyway, the National Bank of Romania will do the best to persuade you to continue. Of course, any such account to discuss about relevant developments in Romanian economy is bound to start from the global crisis and the lessons we learn, if any, from global crisis. In my opinion, one of the most important lessons is that there is no substitute for consistent economic policies. The correction of economic policies errors, and this was proved not only during this crisis, also before, this, the correction of economic policy errors is always painful everywhere, and while difficult to comprehend by the public at large, it is absolutely necessary and remain for years to say to solve the problems created by all these adjustments which were done after you have to correct wrong economic policies. Then my lesson is this: don't make mistakes, because it's very difficult to correct into the future. And Romania is a case in point. Against the background of capital account liberalization, in the run-up of European Union membership, massive foreign capital inflows, which appeared, it was like a flood, fueled fast economic growth between 2003 and 2008, with an annual average of 7.2%. We liked this those days. We never realized how many problems could appear, because all these were leading to the building up of large macroeconomic imbalances. While the monetary policy stance was, and we tried to be very counter-cyclical at the time, it was very difficult to control expansion, particularly in foreign currency lending, undertaken by the local subsidiaries of foreign banks. The instruments available in the National Bank of Romania, and quite even with the recourse to what we call those days unorthodox measures, proved to be quite not enough. And the commercial banks, always they are smarter than the regulators, and circumvented what we try to do. Furthermore, fiscal and wage policies remain strongly pro-cyclical for political consideration, elections, and so on, and particularly in the last 2 years preceding the crisis outburst. Therefore, when the crisis broke out, Romania grappled with, first, a wide structural fiscal gap, around 8% of GDP. It was not visible in 2008, but the very next year appeared like very visible, with a visible, real fiscal deficit of 9%. Secondly, a double-digit current account deficit between 2008 and 2008. And thirdly, with a high inflation reading, around 8% in the last year, 2008, before the crisis. Faced with the realities of the crisis, Romania had to make the necessary corrections, adjustments, as we call it, to mend these imbalances in an orderly way. The three agreements with the European Union, the International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank initially financing arrangements, and later precautionary ones, provided, I could say again, a good framework for such an adjustment in an orderly manner. Otherwise, the adjustment was supposed to be done by the markets sooner or later. The struggle seems to have borne fruit already now, and we already have seen. Regarding production and GDP, crisis-inflicted output losses have been made up for, as the economic advance, as the Prime Minister said, quoting me, and now I quote him, is not only robust, but judging robust in European standards, but looking to the macroeconomic situation is also sustainable. That I could say the economic growth, we have all the data to say that is sustainable now. And why is sustainable? Look to the other figures. The current account deficit narrowed to 0.4, from 14% to 0.4, that's almost zero. From 2008 to 2014. Inflation, another good argument for sustainable growth. Inflation hit historical lows of 1.1% on average in 2014. And the annual rate of the first 4 months of this year is 0.6. And we are going to have also negative growth, not deflation, but negative growth of CPI for the next few quarters. The fourth argument, a sharp fiscal consolidation. I look to the figures, is among the highest in European Union, perhaps is the second to Greece, depending how we are looking to the figures. A sharp fiscal consolidation, which brought the deficit back to the comfort zone from 9% in 2009 to 1.5% in 2015. And moreover, now we could say that Romania fully complies with the requirements of the preventive arm of the Stability and Growth Pact by reaching in 2014 already the medium-term objective defined as a structural deficit of 1% of GDP. And the public debt. The public debt is truly increased rapidly. It was happening in all the countries during the crisis. This is unavoidable, but remained below 40%, particularly if you are looking to the buffer the Minister of Finance developed just to counteract with the possible negative effects of the situation in the area. And against this background, while the onset of the crisis, Romania fell short of all of the four Maastricht criteria, they are currently fully met, all the four Maastricht criteria, nominal convergence. The big challenge that lies ahead, I'll stress what the Prime Minister said, is to ensure the durability of this achievement for the future. Then the future mission of the economic policies is to keep in place the balances restored with so many efforts to have pretty rapid economic growth, but not to destroy balances. And this to be done by shifting the focus towards structural reforms meant to boost the economy growth potential in the long run and to underpin the viability of the economy in the monetary union by enhancing the flexibility and resilience to shocks. Then I like what you said. You said first, in due time to join. You said first, Richard. As Prime Minister said, the second, the third. To join the euro area in due time. That's to underpin the viability of the economy is very important, the competitiveness of the economy in the monetary union when we are going to join. Because from legal point of view, we have no other option but to join the euro area. It is in our treaty of joining the European Union. It's different of Great Britain, which have a special statute. I have in mind, regarding this competitiveness of the economy, flexibility, resistance, resilience to the shocks, external shocks, and particularly asymmetric shocks. I have in mind, firstly, a keener competition and increased efficiency in key sectors of the economy, such as energy and transportation. Secondly, addressing the issue of youth and long-term unemployment, structural unemployment. The Prime Minister said about this. Has to have the vocational education system just to provide what it is needed by the economy. Thirdly, then we need here kind of education system reform. I'm not entering into this. Thirdly, a better absorption of EU funds. This is crucial for Romania in the next years. And fourthly, an improved quality of infrastructure, particularly roads, highways, and so on. Now, let me, ladies and gentlemen, to move to my area, to monetary policy, where it is true that in the case of Romania, I did not have to navigate in the uncharted waters of quantitative easing and negative nominal interest rates. We are not here. We have liquidity, but from the reserve requirements, we have improved indicators for all the banking indicators. We don't need quantitative easing. We don't need, I consider now, that to move lower with the interest rates or to move to the negative nominal interest rates. But this does not mean that our monetary policy is bereft of challenges. There are a lot of challenges here, and I would mention first, the difficulty in designing monetary policy in a context where the negative output gap is closing fast. And we have now the argument to decrease interest rate that we had negative GDP gap, but it's no longer to be, perhaps next year, this time will be totally closing up. And this, to look to this, to the negative output gap, which is closing fast, while a perfect storm could be also from favorable shocks, a perfect storm of favorable supply-side shocks. And I name here oil and food price drops, indirect tax cuts like the VAT reduction for food products, has been generating low inflation readings, perhaps negative, for quite a while now, with the potential to alter also the inflation expectation in the medium term. The second challenge I could say is regarding how to conduct in such an uncertain period the monetary policy. Because we have to view to ensuring price stability over the medium term, but in a manner supportive of economic recovery, and also in a manner to synchronize with the monetary policy cycles of the central banks in the region and in the euro area. Then we have to look around what the neighboring countries are doing. That we are no longer totally independent in our monetary policy, despite the fact that we are not in euro area and we don't have a currency board. We have a managed floating policy. We have to look also around, and our monetary policy is conditional upon the behavior of other components of the domestic policy mix. We have to look what the present government, the future government, will do in fiscal, in the structural policies. We have to look how it's happening with the euro fund absorption. That The conduct of the monetary policy during such a period, despite the fact that we have low inflation, say, okay, the National Bank is now out of any trouble. We are not out to have a consistent, a good monetary policy. The third challenge is the fact that there are still disruptions in the transmission mechanism of the monetary policy. For example, I'm specifically here. Even though the interest rate on new loans in domestic currency have declined further, 2 percentage points in the last months, few months, in response to the fact that we, the National Bank of Romania, cut the policy rate, the annual growth of the credit in the private sector has leveled off in, also in the same period. We don't see any significant increase of the credit. Why? It's a lack of confidence. There are other factors. I consider that this was mainly because the ongoing banking system balance sheet are in the process of cleaning up. I look to the figures. In the absence of the cleaning up of the credits which were non-performing credits were putting out of the balance sheet, the annual growth in real terms in Romania of the credit have been positive or quite slightly increasing. But I dare to say that this leveling off of the credit also reflected the impact of a number of factors that are hampering the functioning of the monetary policy transmission mechanism, and in particular that of the risk-taking channel. And the risk-taking channel is still high, albeit significantly declining. Related to the level of non-performing loans, this decreased to 14% in March this year, compared to 20% last year, but still high. We have, I could say, also a persistently elevated risk aversion in the banks, related also to all this discussion regarding the legal framework of the banking activity. That it's a kind of perception that is not stability in our legal framework. We have also deleveraging of the process of deleveraging in the euro area, and 80% of our banking system are in the, let me call it, holding hands related to the large euro area big banking institutions. And all this depressed credit supply on the demand, because there is also a problem in our demand, as we discussed before. I consider there is an insufficient gain in confidence, particularly in the case of business. That's here is a problem of confidence between the banking sector and the business sector. We have also on the bright side, reference to the same transmission mechanism, something I should point out here, the steady improvement in the ratio between forex credit and domestic lei currency credit, where now, after we have been in this trade for years, is 45%, perhaps. By the end of this year, the domestic credit will be 50%. And I do hope that Romania will get out from the trap of forex credit, which was undermining the monetary policy for years. The fourth challenge is to normalize the operational framework of the monetary policy, which was affected in time by several constraints. And first of all, we do hope to normalize totally in Romania the situation with the reserve requirements, which were very high, increased to 40% before the crisis, to discourage the same forex credit. It was reduced gradually in the meantime, but they are still pretty high, 8% in local currency, 14% in forex. Still high, comparatively 2% in the euro area. We still have a pretty long road to do. The second is the still, if not large anyway, a little bit out of standard interest rate corridor on the money market. We reduce it also from plus minus 4% to plus minus 1%, 1.5%. We still have here to reduce. In the past years, we tried to capitalize on the window of opportunity provided by the favorable microeconomic and financial background, and we rectified this situation when it was possible to do it. What we have to do in the future, looking ahead, it is essential that the National Bank of Romania identify the right timing for the upcoming stages of the alignment process to unfold without impairing the smooth functioning of the markets and without deteriorating the key indicators for investor sentiment or more generally for public perception. In other words, we also in the National Bank of Romania, Mr. Prime Minister, have a lot to do to join in due time, the euro area. The fifth channel, not the least, but I will stop here. I have to mention what it was already mentioned before, that the neighborhood we live in is a powerful source of risks. And I'm referring here, of course, to the still unsolved issue of Greece debt financing and to the smoldering conflict in Ukraine. Both factors, but not only. So the situation in Turkey and the Middle East is still a proximity for in trade. That these factors have the potential to influence investor risk appetite, and as such, the volume of and direction of capital flows. This could put the currency, local currency leu, into the larger fluctuations. And we have to cope with the wild movement of, in a way, either with the exchange rate, with the interest rates, or the international reserves, to cope with the large movement of capital, which could be created by these external factors. And sometimes you know very well, Richard, from London, the situation there, I think, just from the top, not understood perfectly. But what is understood by international investors is something wrong in the area, Romania included. And we have to be very careful in designing our policies. Keeping buffers, it was one solution. They are costly. And that everything is costly. Apart from this unrest in the region, the unexpected growing differences between the monetary policies stances of the world major central banks could also have a bearing on the capital flows with all the consequences from here. I will stop here and not go any further with my monetary policy consideration. I'm confident that this topic will be extensively dealt with by the speakers in the second panel, if I'm not wrong, at the conference. And surely a lot of interesting ideas will emerge during the debate. I'm quite keen to get a flavor of your, to say, perspective. Before coming here, I heard something like a definition of forecast: never make forecast. If you have forecast, never put figures. If you put figures, never believe in them, or something like this, you'll say. But that I need your flavor regarding the perspective of the area, and I'm sure that all the other panels and workshops will give us relevant ideas regarding the present and the future of the economies in this part of Europe. I do wish you success and thank you for your invitation. Mm-hmm.